بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
إن الحمد لله. Our praise and thanks is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره. We praise him and we thank him. Praise and thanks that is born out of love and adoration. And we beg his guidance and his forgiveness. ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. And we seek refuge with him and protection with him from the evil of our own souls, our egos, and from the evil consequences of our actions. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. And whomever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from his infinite mercy, chooses to guide, there are none who can misguide him. وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهُ. And whomever he chooses to lead astray, from his infinite wisdom, there are none who can guide him. وَأَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ. And I testify in front of all of you that there is no God who is truly worthy of worship except Allah alone and without partners. وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. And I further testify that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, the son of Abdullah, is his servant and final messenger. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. O you who believe, O you who have attained faith, fear your Lord, have a consciousness of him, an awareness of him, the fear and awareness and consciousness that he's deserving of you. And don't you dare die except as Muslims. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ. O humanity, fear your Lord who created you from a single soul, from our father Adam. وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا. And from him, from our father Adam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created his mate, our mother Eve. وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً. And from them both, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala populated the earth with many men and women. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ. And fear your Lord through whom you ask your mutual rights, and never cut the ties of family, always uphold the ties of kinship. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا. Because no doubt, or certainly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is الرقيب, he is always a watch over you and I. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا. O you who believe, fear your Lord, have that consciousness and awareness of him, and always speak a straightforward word. Always speak the truth. يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ. That he may repair your deeds, whatever you made crooked, perhaps that he might make it straight. وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. And forgive you your sins. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. And whoever obeys Allah and his messenger have achieved the greatest success that you could ever achieve in this life. وَبَعْد. So welcome everyone. Again, alhamdulillah, it's another Friday where we'll be covering the tafsir of Juz Amma, and we're still going through Surah Al-Fatiha, which is Umm Al-Kitab wa Umm Al-Qur'an wa Sab' Al-Mathani, which is the mother of the Qur'an, and it is the opening chapter, and it is the seven often recited verses. And alhamdulillah, want to quickly ask before we move on to what's on going on today, what did we cover last week? What did we cover, Sheikh? Were you here last week? Allah yusamih. Tell you. Somebody, I need somebody to tell me one thing that we covered last week. I mean, y'all could either volunteer, I can point you out, inshallah. Whichever is easiest for you. Both is easy for me. Alhamdulillah. Anybody who was here last week? Okay. It's going to be like that today. Alhamdulillah. Sheikh Tamam. You were here last week?
Yes.
The chicken was good, wasn't it? Alhamdulillah. Can you tell me one thing that we covered last week? One thing.
He comes in and out.
One thing, Sheikh? Just think about the ayah. What's the surah we covered? surah? Alhamdulillah. What does Alhamd mean? Huh?
Assistance?
Where do we say that? Who said that? Naam Sheikh. Praise be. That's what Hamd means? Alhamd. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he said praise for Allah. Is that Hamd? And that's it?
Thanks.
Huh? I don't have my glasses today.
Praise and thanks.
Are you laughing because I got my glasses? Praise and thanks. Yes. Praise and thanks. Praise and thanks. Both of them have to be there. Praise and thanks. يعني الثناء والشكر. لابد من كليهما. Both of them have to be there. But there's also something else with both of those things, both the praise and the thanks. There's something else that has to be with it. Something that has to be there with it. Can anybody tell me what it is? I'll give y'all a hint. I can praise somebody, but I don't like them. I can praise somebody, and I don't like them. That's not the kind of praise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needs from us. Sincerity? Yeah, I need. Oh, hold on. Now, mashallah. What's that? Love. When you praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to love Him. When you praise Him, you have to love Him. It cannot be, because you can praise somebody, for example, you can praise somebody who you don't like them at all, and you praise them and you say things, because maybe you'll get something out of praising them, out of stroking their ego, so to speak, and saying good things about them, maybe they give you something. But you don't like them. That's not what Allah wants. You have to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're praising Him because of the things that He's done for you. Or excuse me, because of His perfect names and attributes. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is perfect and complete in every which way. Because He's Lord of all that exists. Because He gave you everything that you have. That's the love part. That is the praise part. And then the thanks is that it has to be that you thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the things that He's done for you. And that also has to be with adoration. Love and adoration. Okay, so alhamd is praise and thanks that is built on love and adoration. يعني الحب أو المحبة والتعظيم. المحبة والتعظيم. طيب. So what's something else? So that's alhamd. And then the Shaykh, he said, Lillah. So when we pray, the praise and thanks, all praise and thanks is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so what's another thing that we covered?
Characteristics
or those things that make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deserving of being called Lord. Because Rabb means Lord. Other people, they have that title of Lord. But there's a specific thing that we mean when we're talking about Lord, يعني Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's certain characteristics. Give me a couple of them.
Able to create.
That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates, and more specifically, that He creates from nothing. That He creates from nothing. He merely has to say, kun fayakun. Khalas. He just says, be and it is. He doesn't need anything. He doesn't need materials. Huh? Like a carpenter, we need materials. Like a painter, we gave all those examples. But this is just a muraja'a sari'a. Okay, so what's he said? Create from nothing. What else? That everything, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking care of it. That He's al-mudabbir. The first one, that He's al-khaliq, that He's the creator and He creates from nothing. And that He's al-mudabbir, that He's taking care of all of the affairs. Tayyab, what's another thing? Yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything, but there are some specific reasons why we said that He is called Lord. Naam Shaykh? Al-Razzaq. Because He provides for everything. He provides for everyone. Muslim and non-Muslim. Everything that we get,
The money you have, the food, the clothes. For us and for now, everything in creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ar-raziq, that He provides for everything. So for those three things, al-khaliq, that He's the creator, and more specifically that He creates from nothing, that He's al-mudabbir, that He's taking care of all of the affairs of everything, and that He is al-razaq, or raziq, that He is providing for everything at all times. These specific actions and names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He does those things and nobody else does, He's the only one who deserves to be worshipped. And that's why we're supposed to thank Him. That's why we're supposed to praise Him. Naam? Okay, tayyib. What else? He said there was four. It's namely three. Those are namely three. You can mention a number of other things that make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He's Lord. Right? That He is as-samad, for example. Right? That He is as-samad, that He is free. That word as-samad, it means that He is free from need and everything else is in need from Him. That's what the word as-samad means. Right? That He is free from need, that He doesn't have any needs. He doesn't need food. He doesn't need sleep. He doesn't even need our praise and our thanks. He doesn't need it. But all of us and everything from creation, it depends on Him. We all need Him. Whether we agree with it or whether we acknowledge it or not. Now, and there are a number of other things that we could say, brother, that make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Rabb. But more often, these are the main things that they talk about. Those three that we, the three that we mentioned. Now, Tayyib, what else? He said Alim? Al-Alim? Huh? Elaborate. What do you mean? Yes, Allah knows everything. Yes, that's true. But is that what we talked about last week? Huh? Okay, mashallah. But at least you're participating. Barakallah feek. There's some people here who weren't. Allah musta'an. Huh? Sheikh, one thing. The word alam, what that means. Yes, we talked about the word alameen, and that's the plural of alam. Right? In Arabic, they use that also to refer to like flags or something. Like flags, you know, flags of a country or sign, right? But alam, it means like it's indicating something else. And it's pointing to something else. Like a flag, it's indicating the country that it represents. And everything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is alam. Everything other than Allah is alam. Everything in existence indicates the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By the mere fact that it's there. The mere fact that it exists means that somebody had to have put it there. Just like if you saw a car, you would never think to yourself, oh yeah, this car just fell out the sky. It's a beautiful car, right? You would think somebody made that. If there's a house, a carpenter made that. If there's a painter made that, right? All of those things, they indicate somebody made them. The mere fact that we exist, all of that indicates that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there. Because how else did we, how did all this get here? Why is there a solar system? Why is there a sun? Why is there seasons? Why is there snow? Why is there rain? All of these different things, why do children, everything that exists, it all indicates, and especially with its sophistication and its systems and its design, all of that indicates that there's a creator. Jazakallah khair, Shaykh. MashaAllah. Tayyib, so that's Alhamdulillahi, Rabbil Alameen. And Allah is Rabb of all of those things. Rabbul Alameen, He's the Lord of all those things. Yani everything. Tayyib, so one more thing that I'll just go ahead and say that what we should learn from that Alhamdulillahi, Rabbil Alameen, that praise and that thanks, that should teach us or remind us about the importance of gratitude. the importance of having that characteristic that you are someone who is appreciative, that you appreciate what you have, no matter how much it is, no matter how little it may be. That we are appreciative and that we are thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of the things that this verse reminds us of. That all praise and thanks is due to Allah, because everything that you have, again, no matter how much it is or how little it is, you still owe it to Allah. It's from Him. And something else too, what is beautiful about this is that when we do praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we are appreciative and have gratitude, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَئِن شَكَرْتُمْ شَيْخ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. When you have gratitude, when you are appreciative, when you say thank you, when you say Alhamdulillah, because we said, right, hamd means shukr, wathana. When you say Alhamdulillah, Allah will increase you. When you appreciate what you have, when you have that characteristic of gratitude, Allah will increase you even more. You see how merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is and how generous He is? Whatever you have, it already came from Him. Whatever you have, it already came from Allah. All you got to do is say thank you, be appreciative of what He's given you, and He'll give you more. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Anyway, say it. But we have to be appreciative. This is something that we all have to have. If you have children, you should be appreciative of that. If you're married, you should be appreciative of that. If you have a job, you should be appreciative of that. We have Iman, Islam. You should be appreciative of that. When you're appreciative of your Iman, Allah will increase it. When you say thank you, He'll increase it. But when you turn away, وَلَئِن كَفَرْتُمْ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and if they are not appreciative, if they disregard, if they don't appreciate what I've given them, He says, in عَذَابِ شَدِيد. He says, my punishment, my wrath is extremely difficult and heavy and stern. And so what happens is what? When you're not appreciative, then you start seeing things get lost. And this reminds me of an example that we have of two circumstances or situations where this is very, very practical or applicable. If you think about it, either when you first embrace Islam, if you weren't a Muslim before and then you said, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, or when you start practicing, yani you become reacquainted with your faith, or yani you got reinvigorated. In the beginning, you're very, very appreciative. And every little thing that you learn and every little thing that you get, Alhamdulillah. And you can see in those early days of your Islam, you're on like this spiritual high. Like even the smallest things, you look at a butterfly and you're like, SubhanAllah, look at Allahu Akbar, MashaAllah. And then anything that happens, you're like, you're just so much like in tune with your Iman and your faith and your connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But after a while, after time goes by, after you learned a few surah, like some chapters of the Quran, after you've done a few Ramadans, after life kept happening, after you had embraced Islam and you had kids and then you got married to a sister and things move on, or you got married to a brother and life moved on, you don't appreciate your Islam the same way that you did when you first embraced it. So what happens? And you see it starts to go down. Your Iman, your faith starts to waver. You don't feel the same way you did when you first said, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. And why that might be is because of a lack of gratitude. Because when you have something for a long time, or you're born with something, it's a habit of human beings, we take it for granted. And likewise with someone who becomes reacquainted with their faith. It's a very similar situation. Maybe they heard a tape or they saw a lecture somewhere or something, and then their iman, mashallah, got a little bit strong and they start coming to the masjid and so on. And they start increasing in the good things that they do. But then a similar thing starts to happen. So all of a sudden, they start getting busy again. Or there's a halaqah, but it's too far away. Or there's activities, but I have to work overtime so I can make some extra money. Yani life happens. And they start to appreciate their Islam and their iman less and less and less. And so again, that invigoration that they had and that those spiritual heights that they reach, they're too tired to pray Qiyam al-Layl. Or they're too busy to fast on Mondays and Thursdays. Or they're too busy to do anything extra for the deen. So khalas, you see their iman starts going down, down, and down. Why? Because they might lack that characteristic, that attribute in themselves of being grateful for anything that they have. Even the fact that we're breathing, wallahi, can you put a price on that? On air, can you put a price on that? You could have all the money in the world, and if you had no air, what does it matter? Just the mere fact that we're breathing, that's wallahi, you should be appreciative. But like I said, when you have something for a long time, you might start taking it for granted. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has us reading this so many times in a day, because we should never forget what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. First and foremost, the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for everybody here, that He gave us Islam. Now, batayyib. So the next thing, the next ayah is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And we already discussed those. We said that Ar-Rahman is the most merciful. It means that Allah is the most merciful. And Ar-Rahim, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the especially merciful. Both of these names, Ar-Rahman, or both of these words, Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, they are both names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman is a name of Allah, just like Allah is one of His names. And Ar-Rahim is one of His names. So for example, if you wanted to make dua, you can call on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you can say, Ya Ar-Rahman, because that's one of His names. You can call on Him by that name, especially if you want mercy from Allah. You use that name. Or Ya Ar-Rahim, also one of His names. When you want mercy from Allah, that's the name you would use. So both Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, they point to the quality of mercy. Both of them, they point to the quality of mercy. And the difference between the two, Ar-Rahman. And since I already explained that to y'all, why don't y'all tell me? What's the difference between Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim? The sheikh, he's going to answer. Now what's next? We said, what is the difference between Ar-Rahman and what's the difference between Ar-Rahim? You get an A for effort though. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. Somebody help him out. Is that a raised hand?
One being the characteristic of...
Oh, I know you ain't reading.
No. It's a blank page.
Huh? It's
a blank page.
Okay, then put it down, akhi.
One's the characteristic of being the most merciful, one's the actual action.
Aywa, that's one of the differences, is that Ar-Rahman is pointing to the quality of mercy that Allah has. That He has this overwhelming quality of mercy. Right? As is mentioned, nah, we'll stop there, because this is review, so we don't want to. What's the second difference? Oh, and Ar-Rahim is pointing to the action. Whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being merciful, when He's in the action of having mercy, and when is He in the action of being merciful? Huh? Sometimes? Ya Jama'ah, this is not a rhetorical question. 24/7, nonstop. His Ar-Rahim, He's always in the action of giving out His mercy and dispensing His mercy to His creation. But one is the quality, And one is the, is referring to the action. Tayyib. Okay, there's one more difference between the two. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. And my mercy has engulfed or encompassed everything. This is ar-Rahman. Mercy for everybody. Muslim, fajr, mu'min, kafir, the believer, the non-believer, the one who's righteous, the one who's not righteous. Allah, He said Himself, my mercy has engulfed everything. Tayyib, and what's the other, that's the, for ar-Rahman. And what's the other one? Specifically for the believers. Ar-Rahim, the especially merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is especially merciful for the believers. Or that He was especially merciful to the believers. Now, so طيب, so now we have مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ. مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ. And so it means the master, Malik, is the master, Yawm al-Din, of the day of recompense or the day of reward. So the first word, Malik, it means master or the owner or the sovereign owner. This is Malik. And it can also mean king. Naam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Malik of what? Yawm al-Din. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the master or the sovereign owner of the day of recompense. Yawm obviously means day. And then al-Din, we typically, when we hear this word, we think what? When we hear the word Deen. What do we usually say? Huh? It means a religion, right? But it also means, in Arabic, it also means recompense, compensated, being compensated. Do you hear me? It means to be compensated. That's what they mean by recompense. So it's the day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give compensation for everybody for what they did. That's what that means. The day of recompense means the day that Allah will give everybody. They'll be compensated for whatever good they did, or they'll be compensated for whatever evil or bad that they've done. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَ إِذٍ يُوَفِّيهِمُ اللَّهُ دِينَهُمُ الْحَقِّ. On that day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will pay them in full whatever is due to them. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will pay them in full whatever is due to them. And that's from Surah Nur. And then also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الْيَوْمَ تُجْزَوْنَ مَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. That today you will be repaid. You will be repaid for whatever you did. You will be repaid for whatever you did. So now, what is this verse supposed to remind us of? It is reminding us about the day of judgment. On that day that is inevitably coming, that day where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِي وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِي وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنُ يُغْنِي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us in this verse of the day when an individual will run away from his brother. Wa ummihi wa abi, and he'll even run away from his own mother and father. And from his friend or her friend, and even their own children. They will run away from them. لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنُ يُغْنِي. On that day, you are only concerned about your affairs. You're worried about yourself. You're worried about what, Sheikh? About yourself. You know, today, now, some of you, mashallah, you're here with your children. You would do anything for your children. You sacrifice for your children. If they were sick, you stay up late with them. You have undue discomfort on yourself for the sake of your children. If you're a man, a real man, you would do anything you need to do for your family, your wife, your children, and you would take hardships for yourself on, huh? You'll work late if you have to. You figure out whatever you got to do to pay the bills for them, yeah? And the wife, she'll do whatever she could for her children to take care of them, to make sure that they're okay. Your friends, people who you grow up with, people who you say you'd do anything for them. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said on that day of judgment, يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِي. And akh, your blood brother, that's akh, is shaqiq, is your blood brother. You'll turn away from him on that day. يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِي. He turns away from his brother. وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِي. I'm sure if I asked any of you right now to do something for your mother or father, every last one of you, you would do it right now. If I told you stop and leave, your parents need your help right now, you would stop. This lecture, this halaqa, it wouldn't be that important if your mom needed you right now. If your dad needed you right now, this halaqa wouldn't be that important. You'd get up, you'd go, and you'd do whatever you need for them. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَفِرُّ مَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِي وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِي. You'll turn away from your mother and father on that day, on يوم القيامة. وَصَاحِبَتِهِ. And your close friend, that person you grew up with, that person you've known forever, that y'all have been through so many things together. You'll turn away from them. And on that day, everybody, they're just worried about themselves. Why? Why is everybody going to be like that on the day of judgment? Because all of us, everything, single thing that we've done, good or bad, that was out in the open, that was hidden, that people know about, that it's in the closet and don't nobody know about it, all of it, every single thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring it on that day. That's what the angels are for. When they're writing down, it's not because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't know what's going on. It's not because He needs it to be recorded for Him. It's for you and me. It's for you and me. Because on that day, the kuffar, people who disbelieved, people who disrespected, people who didn't follow their prophet, people who didn't believe in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they will try to deny what happened. They will say, La wallah, I didn't do this, or I didn't do that. They will try to deny it. So the recording, everything is in the book. They say, no. Even on that day, on Yawm al-Qiyamah, even the book is not enough. When they're still trying to deny, Allah will put a seal over their mouth and their skin will start to talk. Any bad deeds that you try to deny or say that you didn't do, your own skin will speak against you because it was there when it happened. It was a witness. Even that's why the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned about when you make the adhan to raise your voice and make it loud. You know why? Because the things around, the inanimate objects will come to bear witness for you that you gave the adhan. So the louder you project your voice, then the walls back there is going to hear it. Then outside maybe people will hear it. And on Yawm al-Qiyamah, all of it, the floor, wallahi, the floor, the lights, these cameras, all of this stuff, it will come and bear witness for you that you made the adhan. And likewise, in turn, if you were doing something else, if you were involved in something else, if you were doing what you weren't supposed to be doing, Allah is reminding us that He's Maliki Yawm al-Din, that you're going to have to come in and answer for that. And so, what we should gain from this, we said in the Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, we should get from that what? That we should have a sense of like gratitude, right? And appreciation. Yani that we should love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, that should make us hopeful. Because He's the Lord of everything. And He gave us everything and we love Him for that. But what kind of Lord is He? Is He a vengeful Lord? Is He a Lord that's going to be wrathful and brimstone?
Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. The type of Lord that he is, he's the merciful Lord. He's the kind Lord. He's a caring Lord. That should inspire in us what? That should inspire in us hope. That even though we have our human frailties and our shortcomings and we mess up and we got angry or we were late or we came a little bit too early or we didn't do enough or we did too much, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Ar-Rahman. He's Ar-Rahim. And then this one here, so that's inspiring in us hope. And then Maliki Yawmiddin, that he's reminding us about a day that we're going to stand in front of him, that should instill in us a sense of accountability. That we are responsible, and not only are we responsible, كلكم راعٍ وكل راعٍ مسؤول عن رعيته. All of you are responsible. But not only that, that you're accountable. That you're going to have to answer to somebody for everything that you do, that should inspire fear in you. That should make you nervous. Did I do it right? Because if I didn't, I got to answer for it. Did I do enough? I'm not really sure because I got to make sure. I got to be careful because I got to answer for that thing. So now, when you put all three of those things together, love, hope, and fear, this is all of the pillars that you need to have ibadah, that you need to have worship. You cannot have worship without those things. Love, hope, and fear. In order for you to have a balanced Muslim identity and personality, to be balanced in your character, you have to have love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that love, that inspires you to do more because you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know all of the favors that He's given to you. And you love Him even more, so you try to do even more to make Him happy, to please Him. And then that hope, that you have hope that you don't ever despair. To despair from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or to despair from His mercy. That's why Allah Azza wa Jal, He said it's haram. It's haram for you and me to ever say Allah is not going to forgive me. He's not ever going to forgive me. You know it's haram to say that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَصْرَفُوا يا قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله إن الله يغفر ذنوب جميعا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا. Say, O my servants, which servants? The righteous servants, the good servants, the ones who are reading Quran all day or praying all night and fasting all the year? No. الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم. The ones who make mistakes, the ones who messed up, the ones who they wrong themselves. الَّذِينَ أَصْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. They only wrong themselves, because whenever you make a dhanbi or a ma'siyah or a sin, you don't hurt Allah in the least. You don't diminish His kingdom in the least. You are only hurting yourself. الَّذِينَ أَصْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. But here's my point though. لَا تَقْنَتُوا مِن رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Allah gave a command. Don't despair from the mercy of Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ ذُنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He forgives all sins. Yani there's nothing that you or I could do that is more powerful than the mercy of Allah. Did you hear me, Shaykh? There's nothing that you or I or anyone else can do that is more powerful than the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why there's a hadith in Tirmidhi where Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّكَ لَوْ أَتَيْتَنِي بِقُرَابِ الْأَرْضِ خَطَايَا ثُمَّ لَقِيتَنِي لَا تُشْرِكُ بِشَيْئًا لَأَتَيْتُكَ بِقُرَابِهَا مَغْفِرَةً. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in a hadith Qudsi, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّكَ لَوْ أَتَيْتَنِي بِقُرَابِ الْأَرْضِ خَطَايَا. If you came to me with sins and mistakes that were equivalent to the whole world. That were equivalent to the whole world. ثُمَّ لَقِيتَنِي لَا تُشْرِكُ بِشَيْئًا.
And you, when you met me with all of those sins, that you didn't associate any partners with me, that you didn't thank anyone else other than me, that you didn't worship anyone else other than me, you didn't associate partners with me, يعني with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَأَتَيْتُكَ بِقُرَابِهَا مَغْفِرَةً. Then that same amount, all those sins that are the size of the world, I would give you just as much in forgiveness. But if you are what? If you're someone who is grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, someone who is appreciative to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, someone who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when you have all of that, love and appreciation and fear and hope, and you have gratitude to Allah, are you going to worship someone else? Are you going to do that, share that with anyone else? لا تشركوا بشيئا. You wouldn't associate partners with Allah. And because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَأَتَيْتُكَ بِقُرَابِهَا مَغْفِرَةً. That Allah will give you just as much in mercy and in forgiveness. But al-muhim, brothers and sisters, we said what? The pillars of worship in our heart are how many things? Three things. What are they? Give me one, Sheikh.
Love.
And that's inspired from which verse? Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. That should inspire in us love. Tayyib, the next one. Huh? Hope. It's the second thing. And that comes from where? Which verse? Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim should inspire in us hope. Huh? And the last one. Ya Jama'ah. And fear. From which verse? Malik Yawmiddin, that you're standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you're going to have to answer for every small, big, little thing that you did. We should all be worried about that. You should not ever get comfortable to a degree that you're not worried that you may or may not go to the hellfire. You shouldn't have that. And that's why we're balanced. That's why you have balance when you have all of those three. Because if you're missing one, you will be driven to an extreme. If you have too much love, right? Or excuse me, for example, if you have too much hope, this is when you see people, they do all kinds of ma'asiyah, they do all kinds of sins, and we tell them, Akhi, ittaqillah, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, Allah ghafoor rahim, inshallah. Don't worry, brother. I'm doing my haram, but Allah will forgive me, don't worry. They say it as if it's like guaranteed. They say it as if for him, that individual, he or she, they think like it's for them, and it's guaranteed. Or if they have too much fear, that will drive them to think that, I have too many sins, brother, you don't know what I've done. You don't know what I did, Shaykh. I done too many haram things, Allah can't forgive me. This person, he has too much fear. That means he's lacking in his love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or his hope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That he thinks that Allah can't forgive him. That means this person's given up all hope. He has too much what? He has too much fear. And he's lacking hope because he thinks it's all lost. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. Don't ever despair from the mercy of Allah. And likewise, some people, too much love. They think like you just make ibadah all day and don't do anything else. And they don't want to live life. And not only that, they don't have any fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you tell them, fear Allah, akhi, you're doing this thing, it's a bid'ah, or it's an innovation, or it's wrong. Brother, only God can judge me, only Allah knows what's in my heart, Allah loves me. Don't worry, akhi, I'm making my ibadah and my worship. Like, yes, akhi, but we're servants. We're slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can't make up our own terms on how we come to Him. We come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on His terms. Na'am. Tayyib. So next it brings us to the next ayah, which is إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. And this means you alone we worship and you alone we seek help. You alone we worship, and you alone we seek help and assistance or aid. From whom? From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now, one of the first things to notice is that the first three, there's a shift. There's a shift now in this, in the verses, and the way that the talking is being done. At first, the first three ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is informing us about Him. That He's our Lord, that He's our Master, that He's most merciful, He's the one who deserves to be praised, that He's the owner of the Day of Judgment. Allah is describing us and telling us about Him. But now it shifts into talking in the third person. Now it shifts into talking in the third person. That now we're directly addressing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was telling us about Him, and now it changes to what? Oh Allah, now we're making dua. We are addressing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly. You, oh Allah, you we alone we worship, and you alone we seek your help and assistance. So now there's a shift where it went from informing and praising of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to now that we're addressing Him. Another thing about this verse, ayyuhal ikhwa wal akhawat, is that the object is put before the verb. So allow me just to get slightly technical a little bit here now. Normally, in English, right, it goes subject, verb, object. Subject, verb, object. So for example, I'm driving the car. That's the subject. I'm the one doing the thing. Driving, that's the verb. That's the action that's going on. That's what's happening. I'm doing that thing. And the object, what am I driving? The car is the object. My action is happening on the car. I'm driving the car. Whatever I'm doing, it's happening to the car. And forgive me, brother, there's all kinds of ages in here, so I got to get simple and break this down, all right? So bear with me, brothers and sisters, inshallah. We got little kids here and stuff, all right? I know you already know what a subject and an object and a verb is. I know y'all know. Y'all older ones, I know. Tayyib. Now, in this verse, Iyaka, the object here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Na'budu is the verb and the subject. Iyaka is Allah, yani you Allah, we worship. You Allah, we worship. Instead of we worship Allah, instead it's Allah, we worship. Do y'all see the difference? In the verse here, Allah is put first instead of saying, we worship Allah. That's how we would normally hear it in a sentence. Even in Arabic, it's the same thing. But instead, Allah is put first, and then us, na'budu, we worship. In Arabic, what that benefits is what they called al-hasr. Meaning that only Allah. Only Allah we worship. So literally the word alone that's translated, that's not there as a word in the sentence, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ, that's not actually there. But it is by the way that the sentence is written, or the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it, that He put Himself first, and then He put us, and then He put the action. So that's why it says, you alone, nobody else except you, we worship. And you alone, and nobody else except you, Allah, we ask help, or we seek assistance. And this is important, ayyuhal ikhwa wal akhawat, my beloved brothers and sisters. Why is this important? Because this is reminding us about our purpose. It reminds us about what? Our purpose. Shaykhuna, it means what? The reason why you are here. The reason why there is a masjid. The reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran. The reason why we have children. The reason why we get married. The reason why we go to work. All of these things, all of them, they are not our purpose. Our purpose is the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And everything else in this life is supposed to facilitate that purpose. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran in another verse, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is one of the verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly states unequivocally the reason why you're sitting here breathing, brother. Sisters, the reason why you exist, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in this verse, and we have not created the jinn, and we have not created mankind, yani, you and me, except that they worship me. And this verse we said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said what? And in turn, we're supposed to be saying, you alone, Allah, you alone we worship. We don't worship nobody else. Again, reminding us about our what? Reminding us about our what? Yeah, Jama'ah, this is not rhetorical. I'm talking to everybody. Reminding us about our what? Our purpose. Reminds us about our purpose. You alone we worship, and you alone we seek assistance. And brothers and sisters, we have to understand, when you go against your purpose in life, you are on a very dangerous slope. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in a hadith Qudsi, which is told to us by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَنَا أَغْنَى شُرَكَاءِ عَنِ الشِّرْكِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I'm rich. أَغْنَى I am rich and far above شُرَكَاءِ عَنِ الشِّرْكِ I'm free from you associating any partners. فَمَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا أَشْرَكَ بِي So whoever does an action, and in that action, he's associating partners with me. Yani, he did it for Allah and he did it for his wife. He did it for Allah and he did it to please some other people. He did it for Allah and he did it to please the sheikh. He did it for Allah and he did it for the sheikh. He made dua. He made a prayer, a supplication at the grave. Oh sheikh, please help me. Or he made some supplication to even a sheikh who might be alive. Or they did some slaughtering. And they didn't say Bismillah. They said Bism Jailani. Or they said Bism in somebody else's name. Allah said, I don't need that. I'm rich. I don't need any of that. And so what happens is what? Going back to our purpose, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes on to say, if you do that, if you do any actions, and it's not in accordance with your purpose, meaning that you dedicate your actions and your worship for me and me alone, Allah goes on to say, if you mess up in that, taraktuhu wa shirku. He said that I will leave him. I will abandon him or her. I will leave them. And whatever shirk, whatever action that they did, and it was for mixed up with something else, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'll abandon it. I don't need that. Why? Because it goes against our purpose. Our purpose in life is the veneration, the glory, the praise. When we say subhanallah, when we say alhamdulillah, all of that is for Allah and it's not for anybody else. And when you see yourself living your life in line with your purpose, in accordance with your purpose, then you will start to see your life, things will start to come together. Things will start to fall into place. Wallahi, they'll fall into place sometimes you don't even know how it happened. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ When you have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and of course that's part of our purpose, that we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we're aware of Him And we're worshiping him and praising him. مَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Whenever you're in a tight spot, whenever you're between a rock and a hard place, يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. Allah will make a way out for you. وَيَرْزُقُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ. And he'll provide for you in ways that you didn't even imagine. You apply for this job, and you apply for that job, and you apply for that job, and you were certain you were going to get those jobs, and you thought they were good jobs. And then somebody, a manager somewhere else, calls you and says, I got something better for you. You didn't even think about it. You was trying to marry this sister, you tried to marry that one, and you tried to marry that one, and then another one comes instead, and you marry her. And it turns out to be well and good. You thought those other ones were good, but Allah provided you from another place. But when? Whoever fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who's ever living his life according to that purpose. And not only that, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ, that's our purpose, وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, and you alone we seek assistance, that we seek help. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, even the worship that we have of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're not capable of doing that except with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Except with the help and the aid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we would never be able to worship him in the way that he deserves to be worshipped. And so another thing, ayyuha al-ikhwa al-akhawat, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or that the ulama explained that it's being pointed out, is that why do we say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ and وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ? So why is it in the plural form? Why do we say you alone, we worship, instead of you alone, I worship? And why is it, and you alone, we seek help? In the tafsir of Ibn Kathir, some of the scholars, he collects their statements as to some explanations as to why that is. One of them is because, yani, if we tried to, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's deserving of all praise, all thanks, all adoration, love, and worship, yeah? And it would be almost from arrogance from ourselves to think that we could worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the way that he deserves to be worshipped. We could never really do it. Wallahi, if you did nothing else in your life other than pray and fast and live your life just that way, all day, every day, it would still not be what Allah deserves to be worshipped and praised by. It can never be enough. So it's almost from arrogance if you were just saying that I alone, I worship you. فبذلك يعني تعبر عن نفسك وعن إخوانك وأخواتك. So you say, we worship you, O Allah. All of us, we worship you, O Allah. Not just you by yourself, as if you're saying like, I'm doing يعني, what deserves to be done. So all of us, we are worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I think we'll stop there, inshallah. To conclude with, أيها الإخوة, we mentioned that what? مالك يوم الدين, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner and the sovereign owner and the king of what? Of the day of recompense, which is just another name for the day of judgment. And that should inspire in us fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to remember or to be reminded that we're going to stand in front of him and that all of our deeds, good and bad, large and small, will be brought before us, that we'll be held accountable for everything. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, that you alone we worship and you alone we seek assistance, that reminds us of our purpose in life, that we are here to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and as much as we can, that we try to dedicate our life and every arena and aspect of our life for Allah, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not only that, that we know and understand that we're his servants, that we need him. We need his help in order to be able to do that. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he taught one of his sahaba to say after every salat, Allahumma a'ini ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa ala husna ibadatik. Say that you should say after every salat, O Allah, assist me, aid me, help me. Ala dhikrika, on your remembrance. I need your help to remember you because I'm forgetful. I get busy. I got so many things that are distracting me. A'ini ala dhikrika. Oh Allah, help me to remember you. Wa ala shukrika. And help me to be appreciative and thankful to you, oh Allah. Sometimes I take stuff for granted. Oh Allah, please help me to be thankful to you. Wa ala husna ibadatik. And that I perfect my worship of you, oh Allah. And that I do the best that I can. Please help me with those things. Allah is teaching us here that you need to remember. Just because you've been Muslim 3 years, just because you've been Muslim 10 years, just because you've been Muslim 15, 20 years, and now you got kids that are Muslim, you still need the help of Allah, brothers and sisters. We all need the help of Allah. Just because you were born Muslim, just because your dad is Muslim and your whole tribe is Muslim and your family is Muslim, you still need the help of Allah. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.